Okay, I'm talking about Chris Jack.
How are you?
I don't think we'll have that to be.
Really? Does anybody feel?
I'm doing fine. You're looking great.
Who does it?
We're now going to hear from the two candidates running for sheriff. Of course, they are Jeb Dawson and Tony Wooten, and we do have questions for them as well. We have a few more questions for them than we did for the other office, but that's understandable, and we're not trying to diminish the importance of the tax commissioner's position at all. It's very important. So I'm going to start off this question with Mr. Dawson. And they do have 2 minutes, I'll repeat this, 2 minutes to answer. And I think the format we're in tonight, we'll let them both answer for 2 minutes. And then if anyone has comments about what his opponent says or doesn't say, then you'll have 30 minutes to make those comments. 30 seconds. I just wanted to make sure you're managing. Okay. Yep, here we go. Starts off on a very somber note as well. Today, is Dawson County prepared to handle the situation such as happened in Dallas? And if not, what do you feel you need to do if you were sure to be prepared for such an attack?
Thank you, sir. As we currently stand right now, we have a very good staff that we have available to us. And to certain extents, we have them somewhat prepared. And I will say this, the Dawson County times are changing. And we need to prepare for the future. Now, we don't think about Dawson County as being in Dallas, Texas, and I understand that. However, if you see the victims that were lost there, the rallies that was held, things of that nature, I can assure you that it can happen very easily at our mall here in Dawsonville, Georgia. I will say this, that a lot of our patrol officers, a lot of our investigators, a lot of our first responders are more than elementary trained. We do have some intermediate training. We do have some that's very well trained. But honestly, I think we need to prepare for the future. I think we need to prepare with our training. We need to be focused on what is to come. Now, obviously, we live in a small county, and that's what makes Dawson County great. We don't want to turn this into a paramilitary organization. However, I do think we need to have the tools and the training and the resources to be able to protect our people. Should an event happen like that today, I'll tell you that every first responder, every phone will ring, everyone will be getting up out of their homes, out of their beds, and so forth to respond. However, I think that's where we also need to have good relationships with our neighboring counties, with their special teams, such as that, with our state patrol. There's a lot of things we can do on our own. There's a lot of things we can do to contain. There's a lot of things that we can do to go, for lack of better terms, to bring the fight to them. However, we are limited. And that's something that we need to be really focused on coming up in this next election, is how well are we preparing? What are we teaching? What are we training? What are we requiring?
Tony, if you would not be repeating the question.
Similar to what he said on several things, I don't think you can ever be completely prepared for a Dallas, Texas type situation. That's not something. Dallas is a big city. It's not as if there's some place on the map that nobody's heard of before. They have great training. They have SWAT teams and ambulance companies. We live in a world now that's just uncertain, and that's the way that it's going to be. I don't believe in money wanting to put back in places like Dallas and places like that, the places that they may have had those kind of things and we think that they weren't prepared for. We have no idea what Dallas did to prepare for that. We have no idea what they've done over the course of the time to prepare for that. I can tell you in Dawson County that we are a small agency. One of the things that I pride myself in is I'm friends with several of the sheriffs that are around us. One in Hall County I got elected a couple of terms ago, one in Lumpkin County where I'm really good friends with. Those are going to be our allies, and we have to have those allies. And just like in Dallas, as big as they are, don't think for a minute that their allies from around them didn't respond as well. And that's what's going to happen in Dawson County. We do have training with our officers. They do have, some of our officers have shotguns in their car. Most of them move in patrol cars. Most of them now have the opportunity to get long rifles and be able to carry those to be able to handle a situation like that. But to say that you're going to be completely prepared is impossible these days. We're seeing this all around the country. It's not just Dallas, it's other places as well. We have to do everything in our power to make sure that we are prepared to deal with those situations. And my biggest thing is I've always been a proactive person. And I believe that we need to work on that now. We need to work on being prepared for an incident like that. We need to start those kind of trainings. We need to also look at putting teams together that can work together and train with those situations. We need to take people into our schools. Those officers that are out there need to go into Dawson County schools. They need to see what Dawson County schools look like. That way, if we get into those kind of situations at the mall or wherever else, they're familiar with those places and what we need to do together. It's going to be, if you have a sniper shooter like that, it's going to be a situation where you're going to lose lives. You're probably going to lose lives of law enforcement. There's no way to be completely prepared for that, but we have to do as much as we can. And I think that Dawson County's done a good job. I think we have to further continue that job. Thank you.
Timekeeper for our next question, Shawnee. Could we add a minute to it because it's just a little bit longer than that? Mr. Wood, this is for you. If we are faced with riots due to an officer-related shooting or really any other matter, how would you handle this? And do we have the manpower to handle the crowds? And there's a second part. Who is responsible for the cops?
Well, I mean, the first thing is, do we have the number of people? I think that's a trick question and a little bit because we don't know how many people's coming. I mean, if it's a small group, obviously we're prepared for that. If it's a large group, no, we're not prepared for that. And we're going to have to get additional resources to help us. We have new mutual aid agreements right now with Forsyth County, Lumpkin County, Hall County, all the counties around us. We can go up to the GBI, we can get assistance from the troopers. Lana did handle that one on TV the other day all by themselves. If you look, you've seen a swarm of GSP. State Patrol were there to help that situation. So we're no different than they are. We're going to have to ask for additional resources in there too. And I think that's something that we just have to prepare for. We have to make sure that we're ready for those situations. I'm going to tell you, we've seen it played out over and over and over. Atlanta did a good job, I feel like, over the last couple of days, over the weekend. But we've seen it played out in Baltimore where we said, just let them riot. Let them just get it out of their system. That doesn't work for me. I'm a private property owner just as much as anybody else. You're not coming to my place and destroying it. I don't feel like our business owners deserve that, and we're not going to let it happen. We're going to do the same thing that Atlanta did well the other day on TV. We're going to make sure they understand. If you need a safe place to riot, we're going to provide that. We're going to protect them, just like Dallas did. But we're going to make sure. We're going to make sure that you don't damage property. And when you start, just like Atlanta, when you start to do things that get out of line, you're going to see the law enforcement presence there to stop that. And if you will, build the second part of that.
The second part was, who is responsible for the cost?
Well, there's not going to be any cost if you go with my plan. I mean, I hope that we can limit the cost. I mean, I don't want us to have a cost. I think you have to be proactive and you have to have a plan together to be able to do that. I think that's something we need to do, and we need to do quickly. If there is a cost, it's going to be, I think it's a trick question a little bit because you're trying to see what's happened. It depends on where it's at in the county and where the situation is, but I believe that there shouldn't be a cost. I believe we should be proactive. We should be prepared for that incident if it comes to happen. If they come to here, we're going to get as much resources as we have. We're going to call in people. All our officers are going to be there, and we're going to keep it from having a problem. I hope to have no cost to have to even worry about who's going to pay for that. Thank you.
Okay. Would you repeat? No, I will not.
Sounds fair to me, Bill.
I'm sorry, I should have minimized that. This is a serious question, so I apologize. If we are faced with riots due to an officer-related shooting, how would you handle this? Do we have the manpower to handle the crowds? That's number one.
You said officer-related, not riots, is it?
Riots due to an officer-related shooting.
Okay. One thing that I've been involved with over my career, and it is most of you may know or may not know, I worked for the city of Gainesville in Hall County for several years prior to coming to Dawson County. We were exposed to civil issues and not necessarily riots per se. They never amounted into a riot. They did. They were civil demonstrations and things of that nature. And I can tell you just from past personal experiences that we did combine with other agencies. We did use other resources. We did our best to try to prepare. We did our best to try to obtain what intelligence we could to find out who was coming, how many were coming, tools and what techniques that they were going to try to bring with them. We were often very successful in our intelligence gathering in that. I think it's very, very important that if we know it's going to happen, for a lot of you that's lived here for years and years, you remember that when we've had groups come to Dawson County with the intent and purpose of just stirring the pot, so to speak. And I think we need to be prepared for that. And that's one thing that we need to count on our neighboring law enforcement agencies. The jurisdiction. We need to have that open communication, and thankfully we do have that line of communication. But we need to have good intelligence. We need to be able to get what we need. We need to be able to find out who they are, our numbers, things of that nature. By all means, we need to do our homework, so to speak. And that's going to be the key to this. And for us to sit here and say that it won't happen in Dawson County, I guarantee you it can happen in Dawson County. Dawson County, as you know, our demographics are a whole lot different than what they are in other areas. Have we been targeted for that in the past? Absolutely we have. So I think it's contingent upon us for us to be prepared for these things. Now, as far as cost goes, I think it's going to rise to what level of the outcome of the riot, so to speak. Oftentimes, if we use, we will gather, we will use other agencies, other resources. It's just mutual aid is what it is. Hopefully, your counties, your agencies work together. They work together to share a cost. When you staff, when you're pulling in all these other officers to hold back the line to create a mobile field force, things of that nature, there are going to be costs involved with it. And unfortunately, a lot of it's going to land on our shoulders. And now, it amounts into a lot of damage, a lot of riots, things like that. I think it's going to be dependent upon what state that we're declared to be in, as whether or not we're going to have funding to repay us for those extenuating circumstances. Thank you.
Okay, the next question will be for you, Jeff, to start off. The question is, what are your views on private property rights with respect to having a party at your residence with over 50 people?
Our homes are cast, and I think a lot of them would agree with me on that. I really truly believe that. I believe that your word is law. You have, and you would say who comes on your property, who leaves your property, things like that. Now, granted, there's a lot of circumstances to it. There's a lot of situations to it, and I think we need to be careful with that. And I remember specifically, we had a lady years ago in Gainesville, and she would hold parties such as these. They would get out of hand. And she would call 911, but this one needs arrested, this one needs arrested. I think that's where good common sense comes in. You invited them, you offered them alcohol, you enjoyed the party with them until you got tired of them, and now it's time to go to jail. That's where I think good common sense has to factor into that. Obviously, she was still a property owner, she was still entitled to her rights, and we did exercise limited enforcement there and have them removed from the property. But oftentimes, I think good common sense factors into anything, especially in law enforcement, and especially when we're talking about private property and rights.
Thank you. Tony, same question for you. What are your views on private property rights and with respect to having a party of over 50 people?
I can't believe I'm getting asked about private property rights. Obviously, I'm a big proponent of private property rights, and I always will be. I believe people work hard for the money. They pay their taxes, they pay for that property, and I believe it's theirs. I became a private property owner 22 years old when I built my first house, and that's, like you said, it's my castle. It was my castle then, and it's still my castle today. Obviously, when you bring in people, you do bring in risk, and with those risks, it still doesn't change the fact that person is their private property. It doesn't change that fact. In law enforcement, we can't pick and choose every situation that we go into. We don't get the opportunity to tell people everywhere they're at, this is the only thing you can do, this is how you can do it. We have to play with the hand that we get dealt with sometimes. We have to be willing to be flexible, we have to use common sense, and we have to go in and use good judgment to make decisions that need to be made. But I'm a private property advocate, I believe in that, obviously. I think most people know that by now. And I continue to say that, you know, I believe that's a person's rights and their properties, and we're there to protect the sheriff's office, of course.
Thank you. We've received some questions that were, some of the two are almost duplicates of other questions. We did combine a couple of them, and here's an example of that. And Tony, this question will be for you. What is the current policy within Dawson County and the reasons for no-knock warrants? Who approves of no-knock warrants, and what would your policy be?
No-knock warrants are kind of difficult. I know they make the news sometimes because things happen that are bad, but you have to remember that officers are going in situations, and when they require no-knock, you're either worried about the safety of officers going in, or you're worried about destruction of evidence. And that's the things that we have to keep in mind when we do these things. So there is times for no-knock search warrants. There's times that, I mean, we have done several of them. When I was a commander of CID, our criminal investigation division, we've done no-knock search warrants. It's a situation where you have to. You can't let people get prepared. I mean, it's just, I mean, use common sense. We can't sit there and knock on the door and say, hey, sheriff's office, keep loading. So there's certain situations that when you know that guy is a violent person, you know that person is going to probably shoot at you, you're not going to sit there and wait until he starts shooting at you before you say, hey, maybe we should go in now. So there's times to get those warrants. And you know, we have to go before the judges to get those. Obviously, we have to show the reason that we have to get those. And that's a good question, but it's also That's why you elect other positions in Dawson County as well. We're not the only game in town. We're not the only person that says, hey, we're going to do this. It goes before other people. It goes before magistrate judges and superior court judges. So there's opportunities for other cases. So constantly, you know, you look at law enforcement and say, they made that decision, and they made that decision all by themselves and nobody else being an overseer. But that's just not true. When you go get a search warrant, you have to go obtain that search warrant through a judge. So it's not like you're just walking in the door and saying, hey, look, I need an ice cream, and I'm going to knock on this door today and kick it in. So when you do a no-knock search warrant, there is opportunities that we've had, that we've already shown the probable cause, the reasons why we need those no-knock search warrants. And we've either talked about the fact that we're worried about the destruction of evidence, or we're worried about the safety for officers and anybody else that's inside there. There's a case that I know that probably stems out of Haversham, which the no-knock search warrant, a flashbang was thrown that people keep to their mind. I think you've got to do as much as you can to have intel. And I think at some point you have to understand that we just don't live in a world that you have everything in front of you. There's going to be times when we get a Monday morning quarterback, just like they did up there. But you have to go with what information is available to you. It's so easy. My dad used to say, I can't believe that quarterback threw that interception. Well, when you're sitting on your couch, the worst that's going to happen to you is you spill your sweet tea. But when you're that quarterback, well, it's just a different situation. You're going to be hit by the linebacker. So you can't Monday morning quarterback everything that's up there.
Do you have same question here?
Our Fourth Amendment protects us from unreasonable searches and seizures. Interestingly enough, I was asked just out visiting a week or so back by a gentleman. He asked me my thoughts and views on a no-knock warrant. I believe there's specific times and locations and circumstances that warrant a no-knock warrant or a search warrant. Again, I believe it has to be a situation, not necessarily drugs related to the destruction of drugs. We have to be careful with that, but I honestly am a big proponent of it when we know and it's proven we have the intelligence to lead to believe us that that they are armed and willing to use it against law enforcement or others. Now, one limited knowledge I have of Haversham County, I can't sit here and tell you what did happen and what didn't happen. I can tell you that over my years that I've been involved in no-knock search warrants, intelligence was number one. We had to know who was there. We had to know who was in the house. And how do you do that? You dedicate the time and the resources, and you put the investigators in the woods, in the cars. You do what you have at your disposal to verify who's in that home before you go execute a search warrant. Now, yes, it is true that a judge has to sign off on that search warrant, but hopefully your judge is going to have your confidence in your sheriff and your law enforcement agency. They're going to look over a warrant. They're going to review a warrant. However, I think the buck stops with your sheriff, and ultimately he's your head, he's accountable to the people, and I think he needs to be involved in all aspects, even with especially, and I emphasize that, especially in situations where no knock search warrants will be executed. There's just no room for debate in this. We have to know what we're going after. We have to be able to justify and articulate why we need a no knock provision, what's there, what's the threat to the officer entering the home, things of that nature. So, in my opinion, no knocks are there. I think we need to be very, very frugal in use. I think that we need to have our intelligence absolute to the T, and that your sheriff, your elected sheriff, needs to be personally involved in no knock warrants. Thank you.
Okay. You just keep standing because I'll start the next question. We've all seen on TV or some kind of media where high-speed chases have resulted in accidents. And so the question is, what is the current policy in our Sheriff's Department regarding high-speed chases, and what will be your policy regarding high-speed chases if you are elected sheriff?
This will be a change, because right now our policy is kind of open, it's kind of vague. A lot of agencies have already made the move to where, unless it's a forcible felony, the chases are not permitted. And often, for those that know me, I'm a teacher and I'm an instructor with law enforcement. And that's one thing when we teach our new folks coming into it. All right, what if you have someone running 100 miles an hour up the highway? Now, what's one of the common responses I hear from our officers? Well, they might have just committed a robbery. They might have just committed a murder.
Yeah.
But what if it's a 16-year-old kid that's seen the police and he just decided to floor it with no other charges? And then we get into a chase with him and we cause a wreck. Now, I understand that the courts are pretty liberal, and that they're we have to do something that's called shocking the conscience. As law enforcement, have to do something so egregious that it shocks our conscience, so to speak. However, knowing that, I think it's good common sense policing. I think if years have taught me anything, can I sit up here and tell you that I haven't chased people for the wrong reasons over the years? Absolutely not. However, I learned from my young mistakes. We have to be very, very careful about when we decide to pursue a vehicle. Why? Because you may be riding to the store. Your elderly parents may be riding to the store. Your 16-year-old child may be driving to the store. And again, what's natural when the blue lights come on behind somebody that's inclined to run? You know, are they going to be safe? Probably not. They're probably going to be very reckless and careless about their driving. So I think that we need to have a good, strict policy. Again, just like an on-op search warrant, do we take it completely off the table? Absolutely not. But we have to be very, very careful. We have to know what we're chasing, why we're chasing it. All too often, and I've seen it over my career and I've been involved with it, sometimes you turn the blue lights on, the kids will run just out of sheer panic with nothing else. And those are the situations that we have to be careful of, and we really need to tighten down, strengthen, and reinforce our chase policy. Thank you.
Tony, do you want me to repeat the question?
No, I'm good. The chase policy should always be looked at and revised. Obviously, times change, things change, population changes. One of the situations for us is we were back in a rural county. I mean, I can remember days here in some of the former sheriffs. None of us up here, okay? I'm talking about former sheriffs. Say, they chase them till the wheels fall off. Well, back then, there was dirt roads and probably one car on it. There might have been the car you're chasing. So those situations change. So obviously, you have to look every so often at all your policies to make sure that your environment hasn't changed. I can tell you as a division commander of patrol division, which I was, I can tell you that I have called off chases. There are situations where I've called off other officers that are chasing. It's a situation that you can't come out and say we're not going to chase at all. I think that's foolish. Obviously, that opens the door for everybody then. Nobody will ever stop. Everybody here, if we say that, then just, if you want to get pulled over for a tag light out, just keep driving. So obviously, we can't do that. We have to be able to say there's got to be some common sense there. Obviously, our officers, I feel like our officers do that for the most part now. There's situations that every once in a while that I question that I'd like to know more details about. I think that goes back to the Monday morning quarterback that I said. There's been a couple of chases lately that's got people's attention. But for me, I don't know the details of those chases. So I'm not going to sit here Monday morning quarterback everybody that I don't know the details are. It's a problem in our society now is we're constantly, as soon as something happens, we're blaming the officers that wait until the facts come out and see what happens. So for me, it is something that we need to look at. It needs to be tight. I believe that. I believe it's a policy that we have to look at, that we have to make sure that we're chasing people for the right reasons. My family's on the road just as much as your family's on the road. And my wife probably's on the road more than all of yours. So, but we're out there with three kids going back and forth, ball games and different things all the time. I mean, we're in the same boat you're in. We live here too. So we're in the same boat y'all are in. It could be my family just as easy as it could be your family. So that's why we got to make sure we're doing everything we can to be right and everything we can to be safe. I can tell you, I don't like a chase that just recently occurred. Not because the officer's here, but we went into a county that would assist us with a chase. I really don't like going in places that we're not comfortable with. That's something I think that we really strongly need to look at. If I'm elected sheriff, I plan on doing that, looking at our policy to make sure that we're strict on the chases, that we're doing everything to keep our county safe.
Okay. The next question will begin for Tony. Tony, there are obviously some officers here in the county that have publicly endorsed your opponent. Should they be concerned of their job if you are elected sheriff?
Well, I mean, there's a few that I've seen that have come out. I don't know everybody. I truly, believe it or not, I don't know what he does, but I don't look at his Facebook page. I have a race to run, and I'm doing everything I can to run and win my race. So, but I can tell you that, no, I wasn't fired simply because somebody came out and supported somebody else. If you read this week's paper, which is still out, I'm assuming, until tomorrow, this week's paper shows that there's about 18 officers that come out and bought a half-page ad for me. So obviously, I'm not going to fire anybody that does his. If I've got 18 people coming out on their own that bought an ad for this week's paper that said, hey, look, we support Tony, here's why. I believe officers should have an opportunity to come forward. The sad part is we have an environment right now where officers are scared to come out and say what they want. And I think that needs to be changed. I don't think we should be able just to walk in and fight. Now, I'm also going to say this. If you have officers that are crossing that line, because there's a line, there's a difference between supporting somebody and criticizing somebody and criticizing other issues that go into the sheriff's office. And sometimes you have individuals who think they know. They may work in one division and they may want to really critique the other division, but they don't know those situations. I've had one in this situation critique me on a situation where two kids went missing, we found them in the lake. The person critiquing me has never seen that case file. They've never worked in investigations. They've never been anything associated with that and don't have the information that they should be making any comments about. Those type of people need to be really careful. Because I do believe when you start criticizing your own sheriff's office, and I'm not talking about just the sheriff, I'm talking about the sheriff's office, because there's other men and women that worked that case with me back then. I think you have to be real careful when you start criticizing things that you know nothing about.
Do you want me to repeat the question?
No, I believe and I understand over my years of experience, I understand that that young officers can be swayed. I understand that oftentimes when you dangle a golden carrot in front of someone, they're going to be tempted to take it. I will say this, that I think we got some good quality officers here. I think that I think a lot of them are opinionated. I think a lot of them, as Tony said, we have a lot that do not want to come out, a lot that understand. I think it's, if there's one thing I could, and I've worked in a police department capacity as well and a sheriff's office, and I can promise you, and I thought about this a lot, how do you take the politics out of a law enforcement agency? And to a certain extent, it doesn't apply in the police department. You come in one day, the chief's gone. Where'd chief go? Where'd chief go? Oh, he's fired. And there's a little bit of turmoil, and you get a new chief in, and things go on. Here it's kind of orchestrated chaos. And what you'll see is I sometimes feel like I'm in a game of Survivor. Who's aligning with who? Who's saying this? Who's saying that? And unfortunately, it affects your law enforcement agency. I can promise you that. I can promise you that there's people on both sides of the equation up there now, concerned and so forth. But I have to say this, and what I put out to them is just this. If you elect me your sheriff, they're going to be held accountable to do their job, plain, pure, and simple. The past of the past, who they supported is in the past. All we want them to do is give you 100% service each and every day. And as your sheriff, as your elected head, let me take care of them to the community. And all I will require of them is I want their service. I want their 100% dedication to this office. I want their 100% dedication to this service. You see, to me, it's more about passion. When I would interview new employees and so forth, they may not have the tools and the training, but if they had the heart to do it, that's what I was looking for, because we can give them the other tools and the training to mold them into police officers. Thank you.
Bill, I wonder about this. I think I got 30 seconds. To say dangle a carrot to me is unfair, so I want to defend the employees that just recently come out. Too often when people have an opinion, someone thinks, oh, they must be promised something. If you read this week's paper, and I encourage you to do that, read this week's paper and see what these officers said. None of those officers have been promised a single thing. The officers that have commented in there talked about how I've been there for them, how I've mentored them, how I've worked with them, how I've been on stage with them. That's important. Say dangle a carrot leads me to believe that you're trying to say that promises have been made to these officers. I can assure you that officers are smart enough to know that there's not 18 in that paper that all know they're going to be the chief deputy next 2 weeks from now. So they are smart enough to realize that we have good people that work for us. I'm proud of those that supported me. I want to make sure that we rebut that.
I can say this, is that a lot of promises have been made. I can assure you of that. They're number one campaigners. They're doing all they can to get their candidate elected. However, again, to go back to what I said, I understand that side of the equation. All I want them to do is come in and do their job and do it to the absolute best of their ability for our county and our county only. Thank you.
Can we get a rebuttal to the rebuttal?
Realizing I made a mistake already.
I was just kidding about the rebuttal.
Glad to hear it. The next question relates to the detention center.
Yes.
And as you know, there are currently several ongoing programs in the detention center. And the question is, if elected, what programs would you retain or eliminate or install into the detention center?
Currently, we have GED programs. We have religious services. We have some more some ladies that come in and offer some extracurricular services as far as mentoring, things of that nature. Those will not change. It's been very rewarding for us at the detention center. We've seen those incarcerated get their GEDs. We've seen lives that have been changed by these volunteers that came into our facility. As long as we have volunteers that's willing and able and ready to come into our jail to serve our population that's in custody, obviously we will continue to do so. There's been a lot of talk, a lot of buzz about time, you know, how much time are inmates getting, things of this nature. And I'll tell you this, and this is a little bit off course, Bill, forgive me about it, but right now our felony offenders serve day for day, and that's an agreement between the sheriff and the current district attorney's office. Is that something that we need to look at? Absolutely it is. But as I campaigned on from day one, I think that needs to be something that our people need to know about. Our people need to be included in these conversations. State law allows certain things. Now, unless a judge sentences and says so-and-so will serve day for day, obviously we have to abide by what the judge says. However, there's other time of flexibility. And I know that's something that's been brought up to me, you know, how much time can we give? Can we get them out of jail quicker? You know, again, is there an absolute right to everything? Absolutely not. Because what happens when you do give them 2-for-1? And then you get them out of jail and turn around and commit an armed robbery. And somebody turns around and says, well, weren't they supposed to be in jail? So I think everything needs to be evaluated on a case-by-case basis. We need to be standard across the board, though. We need to try to adhere to those regimented standards as much as possible. Things of that nature we're looking at. But we'll continue GDD. We'll continue the other programs we have available. Thank you.
I started the sheriff's office. I'm on my 19th year. So obviously when I started the sheriff's office, I worked in jail. We've had these programs around for a long time. I mean, we had church services come in when I started there. Before me, it was before us. Some of these programs were brought in during the time. Some of these were there for a long time ago. They're great programs. They need to continue. We need to do as much as we can to take the offenders that are in there and try to rehab them as much as we can, whether it be the drug courts that we do in Dawson County, which I support, which I've also thrown. We've had Christmas parties for and try to get them and their kids a place to be together for the first time at Christmas when they're sober. We've worked hard as we can to make sure these people, not only those situations like drug court, though, but we've got to make sure that we're doing everything we can in the GED. And I heard you say this the other day, so I'm going to bring it up in a leadership Dawson class. You said that there's a low turnout in the GED. We cannot wave a white flag every time something isn't working. We have to go back to the drawing table. We have to figure out ways to incentivize this program and get the inmates to start working on their GED. We cannot continue to say it just ain't working. We have to find, we can't just turn it over to the inmates. If you want to do it, you want to do it. We have to find ways to incentivize that, to be able to do as much as we can to get these people to be out, to be productive citizens, that they're not a burden on us as taxpayers. Thank you.
Well, you know, and I say we could go in there and twist their arm. We could force them to do something. Because, you know, they're all guilty until proven innocent, correct? My response to that is we offer. It's there each and every day. We've had the GED instructor come back, explain to them the benefits of obtaining the GED. So to get up here and try to put it off on a candidate that I'm the fault of the GED low turnout numbers, that's ludicrous. But consider the source. And I always tell folks, consider your source. It's there, the program's there. We do give them extra time, extra credit, and we encourage them on a daily basis. Thank you.
He got their butt one of my rebuttals. If you did go back and listen and use the facts right, I didn't say anything about twisting any arms. I said incentivize. Bring other ways, incentivize. I didn't say twist any arms. I just said we cannot continue to say it's just not working. We can't continue to just say that we failed and that's okay. I'm just simply saying if it's not working, back to the drawing board, incentivize ways to get those inmates to be able to do something different. I didn't say break any arms, twist any arms, or do anything else with arms. I just want their butts in seats, get a better education, so they're not a burden to our taxpayers.
Okay. We'll go on to the next question, and this question will begin with Tom. Regarding the Sheriff's Department, does the Sheriff's Department receive any grants at the county level?
We do get grants. We've got a couple of canine officers that currently work in grants. I worked with those grants when I was Patrol Division Commander. We were able to go get those grants, continue those grants, to be able to pay their salaries. Some of the catches that go, they do have catches that go along with those. I've talked with people when I've been on the campaign trail about those things. There are situations where those officers that we have, the canines, do have to assist other counties. So that's part of that agreement is that we get those, but we don't pay for their salary or benefits. So it's pretty good that they stay here 99.5% of the time and 0.5% of the time they're out doing something else somewhere else. So we've been able to get those type of grants. We should continue to try to get additional grants. We should look at heat grants and situations that may help us with traffic enforcement, especially with this, whatever you want to call it, continuous movement, continuous flow. Maybe it's a mess. Whatever that is, we need to be looking at grants now that we can look at how to make that a safer place at Dawson. We have a grant right now for domestic violence investigators. I was over that investigator as a CID commander. We have that grant that comes out. We're able to get it. We're able to keep it. It pays her salary. It pays for other additional situations that we have. So we have an investigator that looks at every single case that comes in Boston County with domestic violence. Some she investigates. Some she realizes the patrol officer was taken as far as it was. But we have somebody that plays eyes and ears to make sure that our domestic violence victims are getting a resource and they have a voice out there. And we have somebody to do that for us, the sheriff's office.
Same question for you, sir.
Just to recap, we do have the grants. We do have the grants in place, but for a little clarification, there's always cost involved, I can promise you that. There's cost for equipment, there's cost for training, there's cost for gas, there's cost for all these different things that are often included in these. Obviously, we have to weigh the balances out. Most costs, most grants come with a caveat. Yeah, we want to give you this, but at the end of this term, it's going to expire and you're going to be responsible for the cost. Obviously, any and all grants that we look at, that we propose, that we entertain, we need to be looking at the long term. Number one, we need to be looking at the need. Just because some grants are out there doesn't mean that we necessarily have a need for them in Dawson County. Everything that we do in Dawson County, we need to see if it's applicable to us. What serves us? What are our issues? What are our needs? And then we look and we evaluate the grant. And then we look at the long-term effects of the grant. And what special conditions or caveats are also pending on the end of it.
Okay, thank you. And then the next question will start with you. This will be basically on qualifications. Could you give a good summary of your qualifications for the office that you're trying to obtain, including education, experience, that type of thing?
Yes. Lived in Dawson County for 32 years, and you asked me what kind of qualification is that. One, I know the beat. I know the heartbeat of Dawson County. I know the people in Dawson County. I have I see the needs. I see what Dawson County is growing. I see where it's been from. I also pride myself in being from, although living here, cutting my teeth, so to speak, in Gainesville and Hall County. A lot of things I see somewhere in Gainesville and Hall County we're experiencing right now. 32 years resident. I've policed for over 23 years. I'm working on my 24th year in law enforcement. Every bit of that's been in an enforcement capacity, either detention, patrol, or investigation, specialized assignments. I've worked for a while in a multi-agency organization, pros and cons to multi-agency organizations. I can tell you that from firsthand experience. My education is Dawson County High School, University of North Georgia, Northeast Georgia Police Academy. I have over 3,000 hours of specialized law enforcement training. That is law enforcement training, training that's dedicated to specific job needs, things of that nature. Aside from the personal experience, from the actual hands-on application, that is what I bring to the table. That is my qualifications, that's my experience. The last 7 years, I've commanded your detention center. Your detention center, if you'll notice, we have no lawsuits pending from out of the detention center during those 7 years. If you'll ask any sheriff abroad, they will tell you that their jail is their number one liability. If a lawsuit's going to arise, it's probably going to arise out of the detention center. So I'm very, very proud of the men and women that serve in our detention center, and I attribute that to their success. We've got our detention center medical certified. That's something that's only one of just a handful of agencies in the state of Georgia can boast to. We've been able to accomplish that under our brother tenure as well. Thank you.
Are you ready to get more
in? Basically, you just want to know the qualifications you want to tell us about that enable you to take this office, including experience and education, et cetera, whatever you want to put in.
Well, I mean, when you start talking about experience, for the most part, you're looking at a race that had four candidates and they all had experience. You're looking at four candidates that may have different experiences here and there, but all had experiences. To me, I think it comes down to what experience you do have. Now, we've got officers up there that have worked there longer than I have. We've got officers there that aspire to be just a deputy and slick sleeve, and that's fine. I'm not belittling that at all. I'm just saying, just because the number of years of service, because you breathe longer, doesn't necessarily make you a leader. The opportunity that I've had at the sheriff's office is to lead five out of the six divisions. More than another. Nobody in this race that's ever been in this race has been a commander of the patrol division except me. No one that's ever been in this race has ever been commander of investigations except me. Those are two important situations that we have out there. Look at the news, and I'm not taking anything away from the jail, the fact that they haven't had any lawsuits, I think that's amazing. But I simply want to say that look around the country. It's not just the jail that gives us lawsuits. And I don't think that the Sheriff's Association has got to quit saying the only liability, the biggest liability is the jail. There's liability in everything we do in law enforcement. Don't believe me? Talk to Baltimore. Talk to all these other places that are having cheating. Liability relies everywhere. We need to make sure we reduce the liability in every division we can, not just be happy that we've got it wrong. We've got to make sure it's across the board that we're doing as much as we can to reduce the liability all across the Dawson County Sheriff's Office.
Okay. Next question will be asked to Tony. And the question is, it's been roughly 20 years, I think that's about right, it's been many years since we got a new sheriff in Dawson County. And when neighboring counties have had new sheriffs in the interim since then, and many of them have made sweeping personnel changes. And so our question is, will there be changes in the department made as when you are elected sheriff?
Well, there's going to be changes, I think, with anybody that comes in. If you're referring to changes that were made, such like Forsyth County, where you walked in, 13 people got fired, or wherever it was, I'm not looking to do that. I know there's good men and women there. I think there's some men and women there that may need to be moved into different situations in our department, and that's something I plan on doing. I pride myself in this because I started talking early about I wanted to do a business unit. I wanted to put more out here on patrol. There's two positions that come up. When I was asked by somebody, they said, what do you think we should do with these positions? Why this is going on? I made it very clear that I believe those are two administrative assistant positions that I didn't believe that we need. And day one, I was going to find a way to move those two positions, once they were vacated by the person, into a position that we can put back out in the field. I can tell you at this point, both of those two administrative positions have already been vacated, and they're already being utilized in the field. So that's something that's already started because of things that I've been saying. So I think we need to continue that. The sheriff's office has to be, I said this over and over and over, we have 108 employees. We need to make sure that every single employee that we have is in the right place, that they're doing the job that they feel like they're good at, that we feel like they're good at, and they're beneficial to our citizens.
Yes, sir. You ready?
Yes, sir.
All right.
It's one of those things to where it's not a question of if they feel like they're right for the position. The question is, are they right for the position for the county? And I think that's the key to it. No, I don't see big sweeping changes in personnel. However, we do need to have some changes in our agency. And I'll give you a prime example of that. One of the things that's taken away from us right now is simply this. We have, in our training division, and again, I'm not being critical of the gentleman that's sitting in that position right now. However, when we start taking away from our detention, from our patrol, from our investigations to teach, what are we doing? We're taking away valuable resources and personnel from those particular components to implement or to subsidize something that should be handled. And so there's situations like that where I believe that if we want to be a trainer, we need to be able to train. We need to be able to get out and teach and train our people. We need to quit robbing from Pete to pay Paul. And again, I think that's where we find the right people and we put them in the right position. I think that's a question of number one, do they have the passion? All right, do they have the passion to do so? Are they a teacher? One, do they have the tools and the training to be able to conduct the job? And if not, do we have time and an opportunity to put them in a position where they can obtain those tools necessary to perform? I think that's the key to it. Obviously, yes, there's been a lot said over this campaign. There's been a lot of issues. There's been a lot of alignment and different things like that. But I think it's a mere fact of getting the politics out of the sheriff's office. We begin to focus on our county. We begin to focus on the needs of the county. And we begin to focus on what is efficient and effective for the sheriff's office. And ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, it comes down to experience, in my opinion. You know, I like a lot of you personally. Do I trust you with my finances? Do I trust you with my personal safety? Do I trust you with this cornucopia of questions and so forth? But you're looking at electing the chief law enforcement officer of Dawson County. And I think your sheriff has to be experienced. He has to be informed and educated to be able to put the right people in the right places. Thank you.
I'm going to rebut real quick. If you start out by twisting words every time, that's what I don't like. So I'm going to set the record straight here. I did not simply say, let the officers do what they want to do. I said, ask them, officers, because I do believe we should be reaching out to our employees and saying, what is your passion about? But I also said what you left out of that, which you kind of made it sound like I was just going to ask them. I said also what we think they're good at and what benefits the county. Let's put the complete package back together like I said it, not just what you want to take from it. This is not Washington politics.
So that question will be directed to Jeff. And this is a little caveat. Of course, the finances of the county go a great deal towards the sheriff's department. That's a big part of the budget. So could you give us some comments on your experience in managing the departmental budget, and what do you think are going to be your challenges as you do that for the sheriff's department?
Absolutely. And I'll start by prefacing this, because I know I'll get a rebuttal on that. But we have stayed the course for 7 years as your detention commander. We haven't faltered. We haven't backed away. We haven't given up on it. We've stayed the course. Over that 7 years, we have reduced our budget by hundreds of thousands of dollars. How have we done that? Number one, we had the largest single component budget in the sheriff's office. I know my opponent will tell you, admin, patrol, and CID, all these different components are lumped together. But your single standalone component is your jail. And it accounts for nearly half of your total budget, $6.7 million budget in the sheriff's office. We have consistently reduced costs there. We have consistently saved money on inmate medical. We've consistently saved money on inmate meals. We've taken every opportunity we could to save the county money. Now, how do we predict for that? And a lot of costs that we can predict for. We can predict for salaries. However, the way things are, we're in real life, that we may not have bodies in place at the time. There's a lot of variables to that. How do we predict for mass disasters, things of that nature? How do we predict for exorbitant healthcare costs in our jails? There's so many things that are variables there, but that's where we have to have good rapport with our county commissioners, that we have to be able to talk, we have to be able to discuss. I think, one, we've got to be frugal with county finances. We have to make the most out of every dollar. Because, ladies and gentlemen, I live here just like you do. And I know that's one of those necessary evils. When we start paying our taxes, we hate to pay taxes sometimes. But we understand, one thing that I've platformed on the whole time, this is your office. And again, you're electing your sheriff to represent your office to the very best of his ability. And that's one component there that we always have to be mindful of. As your sheriff, I can promise you that we'll stay over our budget. That'd be one of our priorities as well. Thank you.
The thing I wanted to say was, you makes mention the jail's half the budget. It is, and that's great. But there's the other half to that, too. And we have to make sure that we're balancing that complete sheriff's office budget, that we're making sure we're doing everything we can with those situations. I go back to what I talked about a while ago. I've already made steps. I've already shown ways that we can take positions we have and move them out to the streets. That's conservative leadership. I believe that we should be taking every situation we have, every person we have, make sure we get maximum bang for the buck. I was over patrol, I was over CID, the 911 center, the schools, all of those things at the same time. So if he had half the budget, I had the other half. So and during that time, I lowered your vehicle maintenance costs simply by making decisions. I drive a car every day to work. That's 170,000 miles up to March 7th when I left. The reason being is because some of the days I was stuck behind a desk. Well, those men and women are out there, they're the ones that need the cars that are the best cars. And that kept not only them happy, but it kept our vehicle maintenance lower. And we did that with several situations with people that work for me. If you sit in an office, you don't need a car that's brand new. I had the opportunity as division commander to take any car I wanted. But I made the decision that we're going to have to be frugal. I would love to drive a brand new Dodge Charger. They look amazing to me. But I'm driving a 2001 Crown Vic that has 170,000 miles. But that's what leadership needs to be doing. We can't simply just take the best. We have to balance the budget. We have to make sure we look at everything all the way across the board. Not just one division, but we look at every division to make sure that everything we've done, everything's been done to make sure that we're balancing the budget. I too live here just like everybody else does. I pay taxes just like everybody else does, and I don't want to make sure there's any waste in Dawson County. Thank you.
Rebuttal?
30 seconds.
And this is the point I'm trying to make, is that this is election for our people. And I think being an open and being fairness about what we're doing and what we're saying. And my opponent get up here and tell you that he commanded every division. Ask him personally how long he's commanded. Ask him what the extent of his experience has been in law enforcement. I think what you'll find out is it's been a school resource officer. But if we're going to be open, we're going to be transparent with our public. Let's be honest with our public. Let's tell our public what. Let's tell them the truth.
I think you want to rebuttal.
Yeah. All right. The thing is to say that I've simply been a school resource officer is foolish. I've been the assistant commander, patrol commander. I've been the assistant commander, CID commander. I've been both those situations. I've been in charge of your courthouse, your warrants. When I come into the warrants, I was in charge of the warrants. They came out of the jail. When the sheriff said we have a problem in the jail, I stepped up and fixed that problem. When I walked in, we had 800 outstanding warrants. 800. I walked in the door and I said, what's our policy? What's our procedures for making sure that these get served and we keep trying? They looked at me like I was crazy. So one of the first things I sat down to do is I said, we're going to make sure we do these. Within a year and a half, it went from 800 to 500. This is the kind of stuff that I get results. I get moved because I get results. I'm not apologizing for those results.
Okay, then a question, Tony, the next question will go to you first, and that is, what in your opinion is the greatest challenge facing the Dawson County Sheriff's Office, and what steps will you take to address the challenge?
The greatest challenge, not just for Dawson County Sheriff's Office, but for any sheriff's office right now, is being able to work with the community that we live in. All around this country, you've got people looking at better ways to make sure their officers and their communities are able to work together, trust each other. I think that's the biggest strength that I have. I've been in charge of your community relations. I've been your public information officer. I've communicated. I said this in a debate one time, and I wasn't kidding. I said, and looking across the room, 75% of those people had my cell phone number. And of that 75%, 75% have called me when they had a situation or issue they wanted. I'm not apologizing for being popular. We made this situation. I've heard it been said that, you know, this isn't a popularity contest. I'm popular for one reason and one reason alone. I'm going to tell you that. It's because I bust my hump for the citizens of Dawson County, and I'll never apologize for it.
Well, my name is Flaysburg. We've got to continue on here. Go ahead, sir.
Our biggest issue facing our sheriff's office right now equates to quality of service to our people. And again, I've said it for time and time again, experience matters. Ladies and gentlemen, when you pick up the phone and you call 911, you want to have the faith and confidence that the officer responding is the best trained, the most tenured, the most experienced officer to come in to aid you and your family. And that's where this thing is critical at. We have to stop the bleeding. We've lost approximately 144 officers since 2007. Now, I know that it is across the board, but there's things that we can do internally. We can increase morale internally. There's things that we can do. And honestly, I think that that the times are changing, where the county as a whole will begin to focus on public safety again. I think it's going to be critical. We've got to stop the bleeding. We've got to retain officers. We've got to take care of the ones that we've got, because that will directly correlate with better service to our people.
Thank you. Now we're going to have that's the end of the questions for tonight, but what we want to we do now is have closing comments from each of the candidates, and we'll start off and wake up Andy and so let's just go down the list, and then Gab and Nicole and Tony, you can repeat your closing comments, please. Yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming tonight. I know and understand that most people in here are already sitting on the side. I understand that. We knew that coming into this. But I'll say this, that when you pick up the phone and call 911, you don't get your choice of A&A law enforcement services or AAA law enforcement. You're getting representative of your sheriff. You're getting someone that hopefully you instilled your faith, your confidence in your sheriff. You're getting someone, you want to get a representative of his ideologies, of his thoughts, of his experience. And I do, I hang on experience. Why? Because experience has been my best teacher. I learned more through my life's trials, through my police trials, than I ever did sitting in a classroom. I know how important experience is. And I'd venture to say this, if you're looking for a doctor, you're probably going to look for an experienced doctor. If you're looking for someone to invest your money, which I've never been in that case, you're probably going to look for somebody that's going to be good and experienced with investing your money. Ladies and gentlemen, this is important. Dawson County is important. We see what's going on now. You know, my heart goes out to the families of victims in Dallas, Texas, and across our country of what's being happening to our law enforcement as we sit here tonight. But ladies and gentlemen, this is important. Dawson County has changed. And for those that's been here, and I've been here 32 years, I know a lot of you have been here your whole life. Times are changing, and we have to change for it. This good old boy thing of, you know, if one thing I've heard over the mountain campaign trails, Jeff, are you going to run things? Yes, sir, I am. Jeff, are you going to be accessible? Yes, I am. These are things, these are concerns, but we need to make sure that we're putting the right foot forward. We need to make sure that, and as you go to the polls, think about that. Think about, I'm electing a sheriff to lead our sheriff's office for the next 4 years. Who has the proven abilities and experience and training to lead our sheriff's office? And I'll say this, and what I've campaigned on from the beginning, and this is your office, and I desire to be your sheriff. This is your office, plain, pure, and simple. No matter who wins this election, it's your office. And I think you need to hold your sheriff accountable to do what he or she says they will do. I think you need to be involved. And it tickles me, and again, I know a lot of people are already in the camp here tonight, but it tickles me to see an outpouring of people like this I wish the whole county would get along, get online and watch and listen and so forth, and make informed, educated decisions about our future, because it is our future. So, again, Jeff Johnson, I'm humbly asking for your vote on July the 26th. I know early voting is underway. Please follow us on Facebook. Please follow us on Twitter. That's Jeff Johnson, 4FOR1. If there's anything I can answer for you, any questions that you may have, please feel free to give me a call. And I'll end with this and just say that, yeah, me and my opponent, we don't see eye to eye on a lot of things. We'll disagree on a lot of things. But regardless of the outcome of this election, I hope that you'll stand behind your share. Again, there's a lot of Jeff Johnson shirts here. There's a lot of Wooten sign shirts here. I promise you, if I win, I'll be your sheriff just as well as I will my own supporters. Thank you.
You know, for me, we hear a lot of stuff about experience. I think, you know, one of the things that I was talking to a citizen about before this last race took place, he said, I'm on the fence between you and another guy. One of the things that he asked, he said, no, tell me one thing that would make you different. And I said, well, here's the situation that I think. God forbid that you're in a situation where something happens to one of your family members. We'll talk about experience. Who do you want as your sheriff to show up to that crime scene? You want somebody that's been over investigation? I think so. You want somebody that when something happens with patrol, they've been over patrol? I think so. As citizens in this county, the jail is, I understand, it is a necessary. It's a necessary evil that we have to do, just like every other county has to do. I'm not knocking them. I'm simply saying, but it is a necessary evil. But the biggest impact that your sheriff's office makes with you is not in jail. Because looking around this room, I haven't seen most of you people in jail. I've seen you on the streets. So we've got to protect those situations. And we've got to make sure that you're safe when you travel our roads, when you're in this community. As your patrol division commander, I was also the investigations commander at the time. In 3 years, I lowered your burglaries by 36%. That didn't happen by accident. We worked hard. That's the same thing that I do for. I mentioned a while ago, from warrants from 800 outstanding warrants to 500 in a year and a half. I put systems in place to make sure we get the results. I don't like excuses. I have to apologize for one thing. Sometimes people think that I'm mad. I'm not. I'm very passionate. I'm very passionate in my love for my wife. I'm very passionate in my love for Christ. I'm very passionate about how I care about this community. I'll never apologize for that. I'm not mad. We can go eat dinner wherever you want to after this. But I'm very passionate about what I believe in Dawson County. I say the same thing in every election that I think is very important. When you look to elect somebody, let's stop looking at what people have done the last 2 years. Let's go back and look at what they've done before that. If you've reached out to some people before that, that's the kind of people that I think you should be looking for to lead your department, not just the sheriff's office, but other places. Every 4 years, people walk in the door and say, hey, by the way, I'm so-and-so and I love you. And that's the problem with our country. I love what's in our policy at the sheriff's office on promotion. It says the best indication of future behavior is past. You have to have past. And to me, I have the past. I have the past to be, I've been your 911 commander. I've been your courthouse commander. I've been over your schools. I've protected your kids and your grandkids. And you know, those situations y'all don't hear about, they don't hear about, but we've had situations where kids have made threats. I can tell you, my wife can tell you, when they've called me and said, hey, look, we just got a threat, patrol's called and said, we've got a threat to the school, and this is what's going on. I didn't send people out. I got my tail out of bed, and I went with those investigators to make sure that next morning when your kids walked in the door, your grandkids, they walked into a safe school. I'm going to continue to do that as your sheriff. I'll be active. I'll be involved. If you don't believe that I'm involved, read the paper, see those 18 officers that say, that's the biggest thing they like about me is I'm there standing side by side with them doing the work.
I want to thank everyone for coming. We'll ask the candidates to stay around for a few minutes just to say hello, but we're kicking everybody out in a few minutes. We appreciate it, especially the ones that are standing around the hall watching all this, and we appreciate your intestinal fortitude in doing that. And we thank the candidates very much for coming and for what they've been through the last few weeks and months. As they've gone through the election process, it's not easy. And so we owe them all the debt of gratitude for opening themselves up, their hearts up, to do this for us. So on behalf of everyone here, thank you all for all you've done. And we wish you the best, whoever is elected. And we thank you.